No, we read that last week. It's our base verse. Today we are reading from the book of Philippians 3:12-14. Philippians 3:12-14. The Bible says that not that I have attained this ideal or have already been perfect, but I press on to lay hold of, grasp, and make my own that for which Christ Jesus, the Messiah, has laid hold of me and made me his own. I do not consider, brethren, that I have captured and made it my own yet, but one thing I do, it is my one inspiration, forgetting what lies behind and straining towards what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the supreme and heavenly prize to which God in Christ Jesus is calling us upward. Hallelujah. Today I want us to give that a subtopic that says taking hold of God. When we were talking about the introduction of the anchor holds, the main one was that Jesus is holding you so tightly. And so it is also important that we also take hold from our side. If we don't take hold, then it is not complete. The chain is not complete. So this morning, I want us to look at taking hold of God so that from the Holy of Holies I am gripped, and from this side I'm also gripped strongly. The Bible says it is steadfast, it is sure, it's a strong foundation. Hallelujah. The writer says that it's not that I have obtained, it's not that I've already achieved, it's not that I'm already there. He said that it's not that I've already been made perfect. But he puts a but says that, but I press on towards that which made Christ take hold of me. Christ being God cannot take hold just of anything if he doesn't have a plan. There is a story in the Bible about a donkey that was tied, and Jesus sent and said, whoever asks you, go ahead and tie it, and whoever asks you, tell them the master needs it. And so I believe there is a reason I was untied. I was not untied just to be without any responsibility. I'm not a freelance person. There is someone that has taken hold of me. And that is why Paul says that I know I have not obtained it yet. I've not been made perfect, but I press towards that which made him take hold of me. I press on as you continue with that passage, that I press on towards the mark of the high calling, towards the mark of the original purpose that made God take hold of me. Paul, the apostle, we talk about him several of times. Paul's career was to persecute Christians. But Jesus took hold of him. A hand was laid upon him. And this hand was too strong, yet loving. And Paul could not resist it. Paul yielded to the hand that took hold of him. And that is why he is speaking to us these things. That it's not that I've already obtained that which I was called for, but I am pressing towards of how he is pressing forward, that I am pressing forward. And how do I press forward? I forget the former things and I embrace the new things. I forget my former knowledge. I forget my righteousness and I embrace the righteousness of God. God called him and set him apart. He chose him. He set him apart from the many. I want you to know that God has set you apart. You are no longer among the many. You are different. And his hand has taken hold of you. It is strongly held upon you. That until you lose it by yourself, you have been set apart for a purpose. Paul is not telling us the purpose, but he's saying there must be a reason that Jesus took hold of me. There must be a reason Jesus saved me. There must be a reason Jesus filled me with his spirit. And for that original reason, the mark of the high calling, the main thing. Sometimes we are called, but we only live to the lower mark. But I want to pray, church, that we are arising to fulfill the demand that God placed upon his church. There is a high calling upon the church. The anchor is holding even when we are scattered. The anchor is holding even when you feel alone. The anchor is holding even when you feel time is passing by. It is holding toughly on you. It cannot let you go. Hallelujah. It is holding on to you. God, when he puts his hand upon you, he has a plan. And I want to tell you, said wherever you are, I want you to know that there is a plan for your life. And the plan is not as small as you think. You don't choose for a lesser calling. The Bible says we are a royal priesthood. We are a chosen generation. We are a people belonging to God. We are set aside. And it is one thing to live thinking that you are fulfilling the reason for which Christ took hold of you. But it is another thing to get it from God. Paul says, I want to know that which made him took hold of me. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The anchor holds. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter where you are and you feel so alone. The scratch, the sun is scorching on you. There is pain in your life. The anchor is still holding. When Paul was in the sea and the tempest and the ship was undergoing a very tough time, the anchor was still holding. The power of God. It is not when you feel it. It is there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
He says he pressed on. He's pressing on through prayer, through praise, through passion and perseverance. You persevere, you have to make some efforts.
That is what Paul calls his pressing on. There has to be perseverance. There has to be a heart that is willing to hold on and lean on God, even when helpless. Hold on to that chain. Because as we read in the book of Hebrews, the Lord swore by the two unchangeable things, his promise and his oath. And so God cannot change. If he spoke to you, wait for it. Pastor Julius has just read for us that even when he tarries, the promiser is faithful. Hallelujah. Fight for it. Give it all it takes to confirm that you are in agreement with God. Hallelujah. The hope is the sum total of all the things that God has set before us. Say there is something that God has set before you. So when you have hope, you include all that the Lord says. And that is where you say amen. Because his promises are yes and amen. They must come to fulfillment. Glory to God. They must come to fulfillment. The one who has promised. It may seem wavering, but the owner of the promise is faithful. His other name, the Bible says, is true. Glory to God. His other name is true. So I want us just to look at a few things this morning. That as we take hold on to God, I want us to put our focus on number one, the promise. Hebrews 6, 13 to 15. The Bible says that when God made his promise to Abraham, since there was no greater for him to swear by, he swore by himself, saying, I will surely bless you and give you many descendants. And after waiting patiently, Abraham received what was promised. Hallelujah. The promise. When a word goes out of the mouth of God, God becomes like he follows his word. He has to see it come to fulfillment. Otherwise, his holiness is reduced. So, Abraham had no child when God promised him. There was no child. And the name Abraham meant exalted father. His name already meant a father, and he had no child. Glory to God. 24 years later, God only came to tell him that you no longer be called Abraham, but Abraham. Abraham means the father of nations. God is increasing the promise without a sign. Hallelujah. From the exalted father, which is already a shame to Abraham, to the father of nations. I know God has given you a name. Don't lose your identity because of your circumstance. Hallelujah. Don't lose your identity. Physically, it was hopeless. Physically, there was nothing. There was no hope. There was no future. Hoping against hope means to hope strongly that something will happen, although not likely. It's not likely, but hoping against even yourself that it's going to happen. Hoping against all hopes. The anchor is holding. Your displacement doesn't mean that God has lost focus on you. When it is time, the Bible says He makes all things beautiful. Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. He went against his feelings. The Bible says he hoped against all hopes. He gave room for the supernatural. My friend, if it is not working logically, give room to the supernatural. If it is not working in the mind of man, give some space for the supernatural. According to Gainos, Abraham could not have a child, but he hoped against hope. Was unlikely, he trusted the promise. Glory to God. He proved faithful. And he stirred up the heart of God to release his blessing. When he proved faithful against the logic. Glory to God. You can trust the Lord. You can trust Him. Later, Abraham received a son at the age of 100, and then her son, her wife, 90. And later, he received other children. And the Lord proved His word true. Indeed, He is true. Revelation says, He is true. Truth is His name. The devil is the author of lies, but God is the author of truth. And so He cannot lie. He is not a son of man to come down and lay low. He is God. Truth is His name. Glory to God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Whoever trusts in God's promises will never be disappointed. When Paul was undergoing the storm, he remembered the word that God spoke. That Paul, you will stand before Caesar. And I assure you, not even an hair will be lost. Whatever happens, you will just watch. But nothing in your life will be broken, will be distorted, will be stolen. You will leave that wreck whole. Each one of you that went in. And even when it was hardest, Paul could count on the promise. Friends, I want to tell you, count on the promise. Sometimes we are deceived by what we say. Count on the promise. If He said it, He will do it. He is not a respecter of persons. He doesn't do it because so and so said it.
God. Hallelujah. Regardless of the weight of the storm, God kept his word and spared every life. Set your anchors deep in the Lord. Trust in him. For he is the peace that surpasses every human understanding. He is mightier than the mightiest. The Lord is God. Glory to God.
Amen.
He's the highest mountain you can ever run to. He's a sure foundation. When you stand upon his promises, you will not sink, you will not be moved.
Amen.
Glory to God. The ever-present help in time of need. God is true. The anchor holds. When your neighbor sees it, they don't see it. They don't see it. The anchor holds. When you are naked, when you are clothed, the anchor holds. When you are in a hunger, the anchor holds. It doesn't leave. The ship is wrecking, the anchor holds. Glory to God. Glory to God. When the waves will have settled and the winds have ceased, then you will have an idea that God was in it all through. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Number two is his oath. When the Lord makes an oath, it's a stand. There's an amazing statement the Bible says in the book of Romans that as many are as led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. The Spirit inside me is the thumb stamp that I am a son. The oath of God upon his word is a thumb stamp that God will not revoke. Glory to God.
Amen.
I want us to read the book of Genesis 22, 16 to 17. I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies. Glory to God. Those were words that God spoke, swearing by his name. The Bible says there was no greater name for him to swear with. And so the only standing greater name that was there is his name. And he said, I swear. And when Abraham obeyed, it started the faithfulness of God. Glory to God.
Amen.
When you obey on your side, when you take hold of God so tightly, when you move according to what he is speaking to you, then God will be stirred up to accomplish that which he spoke upon your life. God is absolutely reliable. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
He is absolutely reliable. Number three, his will and his plan. For Paul, at that moment in time, when the storm was raging, according to God, when we talk about his will, that was the best place Paul could be at that particular time. When Jesus was hanging on the cross, that was the best place Jesus could be at that particular time. Why? He was in the will of God. The will of God. Seek the God for your life. Jeremiah says, 29:11, that for I know the plans I have for you. There are plans to do you good. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. And it also says that all things work together for good. When you are in the will of God, even when it doesn't please you, it is the best place you can ever be at that particular time. So don't laugh at your neighbor when they are on the mountain or in the valley. It just takes a switch. Hallelujah. You only need to know his appointment upon your life. You need to know what he's training you for. You need to know his timing, so that you don't miss his appointment. You don't miss what he's training you to do. And you don't miss his timing. Glory to God.
Church, a lesser service for the kingdom of God, but I'm pressing to the higher calling. When it is time, nothing will stand before you. Glory to Jesus. Glory to Jehovah. We bless you, King of Glory. We bless you, Lord of Lords. Number five is the presence of God. This implies the close personal encounter with God. There is something that happens when you have an encounter with God. When you have an encounter with God, fear is arrested. Fear is taken away. It is quenched. You will look for it, you will not find it. When the presence of God comes, it suppresses every evil. Glory to God.
Amen.
Uncertainty disappears. Hopelessness is taken away. Because God is faithful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is the anchor that holds. Even when you feel that you are losing it, the hand of God, the Bible literally says that if I forget you, may I forget my right hand. You, if the Lord forgets you, that is how much you are dear to God. That is how much you are honored to God. And that is how much the anchor that holds you has been hidden in the Holy of Holies, that nothing can pull it away. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The presence of God carries such a wide meaning. It comforted Joshua. This man that came and Joshua was asking, are you for us? And Joshua received strength. It gave him encouragement. Hallelujah. He is our anchor amidst the raging storm. Jesus did not tell you that you will not go through the raging storm. But he gives you his word that I will be. This is a sure word. You may not count on another one, but this one is sure. That even to the end of time, Jesus will keep being faithful. He is the friend that will remain when everyone has gone. The Bible calls him the friend that sits closer than a prayer. That is my God. When the waters have settled down and the winds have ceased, and the rains have quitted, and the storms and the clouds have moved to the horizon, then you will realize that you are not alone. That God was fighting for you. The anchor holds. Rise up on your feet. I pray for you, saints, that the Lord will minister to you. That if you felt losing the battle, I want you to know that God is on your side and is fighting for you. And those who have not known Jesus yet, I pray that you will receive him today as Lord and Savior. And the Lord will be your strength. He will hold on to you. He will be your power. He will take you to another level, to the glory and to the honor of your name.